Is your home a Nickelodeon home?
Nick.
Dad's eating dinner. The dog's got his bone. I get it. That's the phone. Mom's at the table, dishing the food. Everybody's in a very good mood, singing Nickelodeon.
Nickelodeon.
Bud says, sis, what's the channel for kids?
I don't know.
Come on, tell me what it is.
Nick. Nickelodeon.
Be like us. Watch Nickelodeon on cable TV.
Gee, thanks to these airbags here, this job is now a piece okay, Claire.
But Vince...
Yeah, I'll tell you something, partner. I just might stick around a few more years.
But Vince...
No more dashboard du jour or Vince under glass, huh?
But Vince...
Oh, look out!
Even with airbags, Vince, you still got to remember to buckle your safety belt.
Now you tell me.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your safety belt.
Hi, welcome to the all-new Teenage, and today we have a special show. First of all, we'll be talking with a singer whose dream to become a star came true. It's Brenda K Starr. And secondly, we'll be talking to dream analyst Dr. Jim Frank. But before we get into any dreams, let's talk about our own. So have you guys had any weird dreams lately?
I did.
Oh, really?
I dreamt I was in this forest, and that there are like all these Smurfs around me, and they're like, no, I'm serious. And they were making fun of me, and these little Smurfs. And then I dreamt I had like a pogo stick. So I just like got on these pogo stick and just squashed them totally.
So what does that mean?
Let's see.
Bob hates
sounds like you
watch
an animal.
No
more watching those cartoons anymore.
True. Psychotic.
No more cartoons for you, Bob.
Yeah. I know. Stevie did it to my mind.
Overdose. Well, yeah. Wait, I had this really weird dream though. It was, I don't even know how to explain it. Okay, I'm the only child, but I dreamt that I was like with all these orphans, but my parents like watching over us, and there was like these mass killers all around our neighborhood. So my mom decided to get milk because we didn't have any milk in the house to feed these orphan kids with. So she goes out and these kids like kill her. So I see her on the floor with her head chopped off. So being the good Samaritan that I was, I screwed it back on and she came back to life. I swear to God, this is true. And then she comes back,
I mean,
and the
normal?
Kids like want to kill her because she didn't bring back the milk. So she ended up dead, but I kept like the whole dream. I was like trying to save her. And
you know, I had this one dream one time that, oh my God,
what?
Tell us. Sorry, never mind. I had this.
I was ready or something.
No, that a whole bunch of people were chasing me, and all of a sudden I like ended up on top of the building. And have you ever had a dream that you could fly?
No.
Gina.
No, seriously. And so I'm like a chicken, you know, trying to fly, and then I end up, off the building, and I'm flying like on top of the building. So I jumped, and I thought I was gonna fall, and then I start going like this, and I start to fly up, and it was just real weird. And then Gumby was in this dream. When I fly, I'm like, oh my God, because you're chasing me, you know. Well, I love Gumby. He's my idol. Seriously,
yeah. I think you would.
It's Gumby. No, and then I fly up, and I'm like, oh my God, where am I? And then he, you know, I love Gumby, okay? So he comes up to me out of nowhere and he's like, so what's the matter? I'm like, these people are chasing me, and then he becomes evil and he starts chasing me.
No.
And you know when I try to fly, you like fly up and then you go up and then you come down and you're flying up and it's real weird.
Okay, but, Superwoman.
That must have been strange.
Thank you.
Oh boy.
I always have dreams about, like something will go on during the day and I'll dream about it that night. Got a car recently, and I dreamt that night that the car was stolen. Then I wake up in the morning, I'm like, oh, it's gone. And it, you know, I look in the garage, it's right there. But I always dream about, my mind just kind of goes over what I did that day, and then I dream about it that night. And when I wake up the next day, I say, Harold, you covered everything in your dream, and it's really strange.
I have the weirdest dreams, you guys. You have to hear this dream that I heard.
No. Oh God.
No, listen, I'm serious, you guys. I had the weirdest dream. Okay, you were in it. Melissa was in it, and Harold was in it.
Okay.
Okay, now don't, like, start, you know, okay. It's really weird. Okay, we're in this car.
Thank you.
kids want to buy a magic lamp?
We're not interested.
Wait a minute, wait. You don't understand. Look, look, here it is.
Guys, he's a psychopath nut. Let's go.
Ain't it a beauty?
Guys, wait a minute.
It'll make all your dreams come true. It'll make you into whatever you want to be.
Yeah, really.
This is magic. You don't understand. It'll make all your dreams come true. It'll make you into whatever you want.
Hey, wait a minute, guys. How much do you want for it?
$2.
Okay, I'll take it. Shannon!
It's okay.
Oh, come on.
She's so gullible.
Oh, my God. That's too. Don't touch him.
Oh,
oh,
my God.
Oh, come on.
Oh, great genie of the lamp, heed thy call and make thyself visible.
Shannon,
you're a nut.
Oh, my God.
Come on, don't you believe in magic?
Yeah. You too? My God, you guys belong in an insane asylum.
Come with us, dear.
This sounds great, would you?
Oh, there. Nice.
Scoring. Whoa, my God, where's my wish? Make me Oprah. Genie. Okay. Dude, my name is not Genie, it's Eugene. Get it right.
Totally
shocked. Oh my God, this is so cool. Can you believe this?
I told you.
You lose, buddy.
Nice going.
Second thing. Everybody's heard all the story. I'm not going to say it again. Now everybody gets one wish except you. You don't believe. You threw me in the trash. You're out of here. You, little dude, what do you want? Let's make it snappy.
Me? What do I want?
Let's see, I could have world peace? No. I could wish for global starvation? No. I know, a cure for cancer. Yes. That's... No.
I want a Trans Am!
A Trans Am! I want a Trans Am!
Your wish is my command.
Oh my God! Thank you! Thank you!
Now you, little sweetie, what do you want?
That's easy. I've always wanted to be an actress. Somebody godlike and great. Kind of like Oprah, but cooler.
Your wish is granted.
Shannon, we are very interested in representing you. You are a major figure in the industry.
Shannon, will you marry me?
Please go away.
Oh, please. One of the first things we're going to have to talk about is personal protection.
You know, I want you. Please.
Please go away. I'm busy.
With office like this, but I'm talking financial office. You know what I'm saying, sweetheart?
Shannon, I need you.
Well,
I can't
get him out of here.
Oh, really?
Let's go.
Anyways, we're talking
major movies.
I mean, we're talking all the best producers, all the best studios. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we're talking major dollars.
And so here I am. What a dream, right? Yeah.
That was really weird.
I would like to have lived that one.
Hey, come on, I'm serious. It was true.
Okay, Shannon.
Yeah, I'm sure. A lot of genies out there.
Don't you believe in magic?
My turn, Shannon. I had this dream. It was so cool. There was this beautiful Cadillac, Seville, of course. And Melissa was in it, and so was Diane. And we were in this Cadillac. It had everything. It had, like, a panel. It was like, seen us. We look so cool.
Yeah. You are scary.
We were
I'm sure you did.
Well, I had a dream about teenage. I was It's more like a nightmare. All right, well, like the show. No, a real nightmare. I mean, it was like Saturday morning and we had to tape or something. And I just totally forgot. I mean, I wake up and... But then, of course, it was only a dream. But I want to say, you guys look really macho when you're old and ugly.
Oh, thank you.
Sure, anytime.
Old and ugly.
Oh, and you never grow old, I'm sure.
Oh, no. I'm like Gary Coleman.
It's tough.
Well, sex is kind of a touchy subject for my parents to talk about and myself.
A lot of parents think because if you ask them a question about sex, they automatically think you are asking because you want to have sex. But it's not.
A recent survey shows teenagers here in Illinois want more information about human sexuality from their parents. It's tough, but it's time to start talking. Parents Too Soon can help.
It's hard to sit there, isn't it? Knowing there's a hole in the ozone 3,000 miles wide. With acid rain threatening marine and wildlife, knowing toxic waste can last thousands of years. The greenhouse effect raising temperatures. 10 million trees cut down every year. Air pollution at its worst in a decade. Sewage and chemical waste strangling our lakes and oceans. Have we forgotten anything?
And now we have a specialized interview with rock's most hottest singing sensation, Connie Francis. No, really. We're going to be interviewing Brenda K Starr, and to do it is Tracy Vivona, who is on location at the Riviera Nightclub.
Do you feel that you've missed out on anything, like with your success, you being on the road, missing out on like school, college, your friends, you know? Do you feel like you've missed out on a lot?
No, because it's just like I said, it's really a job. It's not like missing out on anything. You still get to do the same things that other teenagers or, you know, adults get to do as you get older. I mean, it's like you go to school, and if you can't go to school, you get a tutor, but you still have friends from your old neighborhood, and you don't work 24/7. You know, there's times that you get off, and the times that you get off, you spend with your family or you go on dates. I go on dates. I meet a lot of people. And I have a lot of friends and a lot of acquaintances as well. A lot of people want to be your friend because of who you are, but you just have to take it in a different, you know, a different direction. You don't have to think that they want to be your friend because you're Brenda K Starr. So it's like, I have a lot of friends. There's a lot of people I know.
What about your music? Do you most of your own songs or?
Yeah, well, I enjoy writing a lot of my stuff. But what I don't enjoy is that I don't like to make my own decisions. I like people to, you know, submit songs for me. And when they submit songs to me, I listen to them. And if the songs that I write are not as good as the songs that they give me, I usually take their songs because I feel, you know, some of their material is better than mine.
You know, do you still do any like break dancing or street dancing or anything?
Well, it's
like
weird because, yeah, I do. I do a lot of that on my stage shows. I mean, because it's like I never forgot where it came from. And I always remember that a lot of people enjoy seeing that. Actually, one of the dynamic dolls is my roommate right now. Her name is Susie. So it's really, I mean, I always enjoy dancing. I still do it.
So do you live like in an apartment or do you have like a house now?
No, actually I have a condo in New Jersey and I'm about to move out. I just got a beautiful condo in LA. Just bought a house for my mom in Jacksonville, Florida with a pool and a backyard and a picket fence.
Isn't that one of your dreams or something? You wanted to be able to buy a house for your mom?
Yeah, that was my first dream and then I got real successful with it, I still believe. So forgetting I'm real successful with it, I still believe. I bought my mom a house, so that's out the way. Now it's my turn to get myself a house. I mean, I enjoy living in a condo because right now I wouldn't be able to obtain a house anyway because my schedule is so hectic. But I mean, one of these days when I decide on having a family, I want to have a house. I don't want to live in an apartment.
How does your family feel about your success? I mean, is it still basically normal family, you know, fights or...
Oh,
you know,
yeah, forget it. I mean, it's like I still fight with my brother, get out of my room when I'm living at home. And now it's like weird, you know. As I started singing a lot more and going on the road, when I come home, we spend a lot of time together. And we don't argue, but I have my younger brother who, well, he's older than I am, but, you know, he's like, I'm the youngest out of the whole family. He's the youngest out of all five boys, because there's seven of us. He's real funny. He calls a lot at home, and he says how much he loves me and how much he misses me, and he calls me Butthead. You know, it's funny, you know.
Is anybody else in your family in show business besides your father, any of your siblings, or?
Yeah, my sister was a Levi's 501 model. Mm-hmm. She did a commercial. I did a Levi's 501 commercial. And my mom was a go-go dancer at Trudy Heller's. That's how she met my dad. And my brother does sound and light and engineering for me. And my brother, the oldest brother I had, he was a boxer. He won the Golden Gloves four times in a row. He was Alexis Aguayo's sparring partner. And I don't know. My family all together is very successful. Anybody can be successful in their family, even if they don't sing or dance or act, as long as you're away from drugs and you do something that'll, you know, benefit your life on a well basis. It doesn't matter. Just going to school makes you successful.
How did you get started? What was, you know, I know you did a lot of, you know, when you were younger, a lot of school, you know, choir, like you said, but what was really your big break?
I used to be in one day I went to newsstand and my mom was like, where are you going? I said, I'm gonna go get a lollipop at the store. And I got a paper called Show Business. And then we're auditioning for Annie. And I found out where it was and I found out how to get there. And I took the bus there and I tried out for Annie. I was too tall. People saw me sing from there and they asked me to be in off-Broadway shows such as Nanny Saperstein's First All Children's Theater. And then my big, big break was Beat Street with Harry Belafonte.
And how old were you then?
I was 17. I came home, I said, Mom, I'm gonna be in a movie. She's like, oh yeah, right, come back. I'm like, Mom, really, I'm gonna be in a movie. So the next day, I says, Mom, you gotta come with me, get up, we gotta go to the set. So we went there and I really, you know, I was really in a movie. She was like, wow, you know, my daughter's in the movie. So I was like, hi, Ma, you know?
Did you wanna sing or did you wanna get in more acting or?
I wanted to do everything. I was always an extroverted person. This earring's annoying. I was always doing everything. I was dancing, I was singing, I was a clown in school, I was always making jokes. You know, I just wanted to be the center of attraction no matter what type of career or, you know, whatever, you know, life setting I wanted. I just wanted to be famous. I wanted to see my name in lights. First time I saw my name in lights, it was in this club called Roseland, and I went in front of Roseland and I saw it and I was like, Mom, my name is in lights. And my mother was like, I know, I already saw it. She had took a picture of it. And it was real funny because I've always been the center of Jackson. I'm a big ham.
Are you happy with what you're doing now? Are you enjoying it?
Oh, yeah. I really love it. I meet a lot of nice people, and it's really nice. You know, I'm real thankful to God that he gave me a gift and I could, you know, share it with everyone, you know. I mean, it's a good job, you make good money, but money isn't everything, you know? It's always to be happy and to enjoy and make other people around you happy. I have two children. I have two children in Mexico, but they're not my children. I didn't have them. I support them, you know, like they have the care service, and I send them money, and I know that they're very unfortunate and they don't have, so I send them money, and I feel fortunate, so this is like, that's successful for me right there.
No, no, no. first on MTV.
Hi, welcome back to Teenage. As you've seen, we've done some of our own dream sequences, and we're here today with the dream analyst, Jim Frank, who teaches at College of DuPage. Hi, Jim, how you doing?
Hi, Maria, fine.
It's good.
I have a question. Why do you interpret dreams? How does it benefit people to learn about them? I mean, why do you do it? Why did you get into that subject?
Mm-hmm. Well, in my role as a counselor at the college, I'm frequently invited by people to help them make some decisions, whether it be about their education or their futures or their occupations. Maybe it's about relationships. And frequently they come in when they're feeling stuck. And I think one of the reasons they get stuck much of the time is, like all of us, when we try to solve a problem, we use our brain, our intellect, our logic. And we live in a culture that values logic. And logic is kind of a step-by-step way of looking at a problem. And one of the things that working with dreams does, another way of working is called imagery, is to draw on the right side of the brain, if you've studied anything about the brain, that uses a more imaginative way of looking at a situation. And it kind of frees up people, it helps them get unstuck, and allows them to see their situation in a very new and different way. So they get some new insights about a situation they hadn't had before.
And dreams can do that for you, though.
Dreams are probably one of the quickest ways to get there.
Okay, I have this problem. It's not really a problem. But when I dream, it's real weird because I'll have a dream, and it's not a nightmare or anything. Like, I had a dream about a cat, and I hate cats. So I had the power to, like, not the power, but I changed it to a dog. Mm-hmm. And it was real weird, and I couldn't understand why I could do that when I have something in my dream that I don't like. I could change it, or change the clothes I'm wearing, or something like that. Mm-hmm. Why is that?
First of all, that's known as lucid dreaming, which means that even while we're dreaming, part of us knows that we're dreaming. It's kind of like we're watching something happen, and we decide we don't like it, and we change it in the middle. Very few people can do that, and there's a saying, as in dreams, so in life. And if we, for example, in a dream are feeling like we're a victim of something, we can change that from becoming more active and maybe assertive or aggressive. And so my hunch is that if you're able to do that in your dream life, my hunch is, without even knowing you, is that you're pretty much able to feel in control and in charge of your waking life and what's going on around you in your personal life. Dreams get very, very quickly at the deeper selves that lie within us. And,
I have this problem, too. They don't send me away, but when I go away on vacation or something and I'm not with my parents, I have the tendency to sleepwalk and wake up in very strange places. Like when I went to camp, I'd wake up sitting on the bench in the front of the cabin where they have a bench, or I'd end up by someone's bed, and it was real weird.
Researchers still don't know what it is that makes us do that. There's some mechanism in our mind that allows us to dream and watch this drama that, as we all know, when we dream, we come up with the strangest things. But we're able to watch it, but we're still lying still, because there's an inner mechanism in our brain that says, you're only dreaming. But somehow when we sleepwalk or sleep talk, which I used to do very much as a younger person, that mechanism breaks down a little bit. With my wife sometimes, when she talks in her sleep, I will start conversing with her. And it allows her to amplify her dream even more because it encourages her to do that.
So how do you interpret dreams?
Well, okay, one answer to that question, and I'd like to get back to Melissa's thing about the cat and the dog for a minute, and one way to interpret dreams is to pay attention to the symbols that we find in them. So, for example, in this dream, there were cats and dogs. And one of the things you could do, and if you'd like to try it now, we could, is just you change from a cat to a dog for some reason. You didn't like the cat, or you just wanted to be the dog in the dream. So let's all associate with that for a minute. What is a dog? What do we know about dogs?
They're
what
cute,
are some of their
cuddly.
Characteristics?
They're
cute.
Loyalty.
They're
cuddly.
Loyal.
They bark.
They're friendly.
They're loud. They bite people.
Sometimes they're ferocious. They bark, they make noise.
They're hyper.
I'm sorry.
Hyper.
Can be hyper, cuddly.
Can be trained.
Can be trained.
But most of them are not.
What's the, if you had to pick one characteristic of a dog, though, what characteristic would you, or quality do dogs have different from other animals, for example?
Loyal. Family
loyalty.
Pet.
Loyalty.
I would
loyalty,
agree.
Yeah.
So what I would do with you in that is to just ask you to think about your waking life, and you don't have to do that here now. You can stay in your own private world here. But ask yourself the question, okay, is there something going on in my waking life about loyalty? Could it be in a relationship I'm in? Could it be how I feel about an institution, a school, a church, a person?
I never thought of it
that way. A goal? And so dreams then give us different ways of looking at our waking lives. And just by, you know, the dream gave us the symbol. Your unconscious brought that up. Our task is to try to interpret it. And one of the ways we do that, getting back to your question, is to what we call free associate. So when we have a symbol, if it's a car, well, what is a car? We ask ourselves, what is the function of a car? Well, it transports people. It moves people. Oh, really? Where in my life am I moving? Where in my life am I changing? Going from one place to another? And so it depends on what the dream then reveals, and you get into it that way. So that's one way, Bob, to get at it, is to pay attention to some of the symbols.
Well, how are you supposed to deal with that? Because, like, with my friends, if I had to say, oh, I had the weirdest dream last night, and they'll say, well, what was it about? You know, well, we'll talk about it. We'll say, well, what could that mean, you know? Well, what could that mean? And it could mean, like, 12. We'll come up with, like, 12 different possible ideas how it could pertain to my life.
But the inner you knows. When you really know of all these possible meanings that you hear friends suggest or that you come up with yourself, we get this, what I call the aha experience. Ah. And it's kind of like you ever wake up in the morning and leave your house and wonder, oh, I forgot something. Mm-hmm. And you all day long you're wondering about it. And then 2 p.m, you go,
oh, that's what it was.
Okay,
that's
well,
the feeling you get. That's when you know.
So you just know.
Okay, well, thanks a lot for being here today.
You're
and
welcome.
We'll see you next time on Teenage.
Thank you for your questions.
Yeah, sure.
Really interesting.
That's right.